And good morning, friends. Welcome to The Bright Side. I am Pharmacist Ben. Thanks for joining us. Our number, as always, on The Bright Side, 844-236-6010. And as always, we love hearing from you. If you have questions, comments, success stories, or if you just want to contribute to the conversation, 844-236-6010 is our number. We'll get your calls in our next segment. I'm super excited to speak to our guest at the bottom of the hour. Kelly Sullivan Walden is a dream expert. She's on a mission to awaken the world to the power of dreams. I have been studying dreams personally for many, many years. And, man, there's very few things that you can do in your life if you want to improve your personal reality, improve your day-to-day personal reality, than to understand your dreams. The most important thing I think about dreams is that they're not literal, they're symbolic. And understanding the symbolism of dreams is probably the best way to understand what's going on in your subconscious mind. And of course, we know that how our life shows up is a function of our subconsciousness. That is the things that are underneath our consciousness. And of course, you can't, by definition, you can't know what's underneath your consciousness. You can't know what's in your subconscious. By definition, it's subconscious. However, by understanding your dreams, your subconscious thoughts, your subconscious mind can be revealed to you. That's the power of dreams. It reveals to us our subconscious, because our life is a reflection of our subconscious. Understanding your dreams is probably the single most powerful thing you can do in your life if you want to change, if you want to expand, if you want to just have a wonderful, beautiful life, which we all want to do. We'll talk to Kelly Sullivan Walden at the bottom of the hour, author of the book, The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle. And we'll get your calls in our next segment, 844-236-6010. If you want to purchase Youngevity products, go to brightsideben.com, pharmacistben.com, or criticalhealthnews.com, or even better, if you want to start a home-based business, click on the Join the Team link at brightsideben.com, pharmacistben.com, or criticalhealthnews.com, or call 866-735-2470 for more information, and also to order products, 866-735-2470. All right, our number 844-236-6010. We'll get your calls in our next segment. Kelly Sullivan Walden will be talking dreams with us and dream analysis at the bottom of the hour. And we'll get your calls in our next segment. So we have been talking about the power of enzymes, proteases, lipases, amylases, cellulases. All of these enzymes are found in foods. They're found in the body, with the exception, of course, of cellulases, which are enzymes that break up fiber. Whenever you hear the word ACE, A-S-E, or the suffix ACE at the end of a word, protease, lipase, amylase, you're dealing with an enzyme. A protease is a protein-dissolving enzyme. A lipase is a fat-dissolving enzyme. An amylase is a starch-dissolving enzyme. There's lots of enzymes in the body. They're not all digestive enzymes. In fact, digestive enzymes are just one type of enzyme. There's also metabolic enzymes. Metabolic enzymes are the enzymes that help run our body. Digestive enzymes and metabolic enzymes are interchangeable in the sense that when the body runs out of digestive enzymes, it can use metabolic enzymes and it does use metabolic enzymes. And this is a very interesting point that Dr. Edward Howell noticed. He said that when we don't have enough digestive enzymes, our body will use metabolic enzymes, and then we won't have enzymes to run our body. Enzymes are the giver of life. Yeah, nutrition is important, definitely important. The mighty 90 essential nutrients are important. But it's enzymes that pull the molecules together. Nothing in biology would happen without enzymes. It's when you think about what the body is, it's really the end result of molecules hitting each other, and then the word is reacting. They connect with each other, and then you have a chemical reaction. Chemicals have to connect in order for a reaction to occur, and that would never happen without enzymes. Enzymes assure that reactions will occur. That's why there's no life without enzymes. There's no reactions. There's no chemical reactions without enzymes. When we think about enzymes, we think about digestive enzymes, and digestive enzymes help digestive reactions occur, digestive chemistry occur, but all the chemical reactions of the body, the reactions that make collagen, the reactions that run your immune system, the reactions that build your bones, the reactions that run your brain and your neurology, they're all dependent on enzymes. Everything is dependent on enzymes. And when you run out of enzymes, you run out of life. And the less enzyme activity you have, the less life activity you have. And by the way, it's not just the enzymes, it's the environment that the enzymes are in. The reason why water is so important is because the enzymes are designed to work in a milieu of water. When you don't have enough hydration, the enzymes do not work as effectively to the degree that you don't have hydration. Likewise with pH and acidity. The reason why low pH or low acidity or alkaline pH is so important, you know, you've all heard alkalinize or die. The idea that you want to have your blood pH 7.38 exactly. When it's too high or too low, the enzymes don't work. The reason you want to have the body's environment just so, within tolerances, within specifications, is because through evolution, millions, billions of years of evolution, enzymes have been adjusted through evolution to work at a certain pH, to work at a certain level of hydration, to work with certain nutrients. In fact, many nutrients are said to be coenzymes because they facilitate the work of enzymes. So enzymes are super duper important. I said there's metabolic enzymes and there's digestive enzymes. There's actually a third type of enzyme, and this is really relevant. It's called a food enzyme. Basically, these food enzymes are found in plants, but there's other sources. Raw milk is a great source of enzymes. Not cooked milk, i.e. pasteurized milk, but raw milk is a great source of enzymes. Raw eggs are a great source of enzymes. So if you're a carnivore, and you're not eating vegetables, or you're dismissive of the importance of vegetables, which is unfortunate in my opinion, but if say you are, make sure you're using raw eggs and raw milk so you'll get your enzymes. Cooking destroys enzymes. This is one of the huge problems with our modern lifestyle, with our modern way of eating, is we cook our foods to the degree, and by the way, cooking is important. I'm not saying cooking's not important, and there's a lot of nutritionists will tell you, correctly actually, they'll tell you that when we learned to cook meat, the nutrients in the meat became much more accessible to us, and this is one of the reasons, according to evolutionary biologists, why our brain developed so well, is because we in the animal kingdom, human beings singularly, the only animals in the animal kingdom that cook their meat are humans. And it is thought that when we learn to cook our meat, we release a lot of the nutrients. So I'm not saying you shouldn't cook your meat or cook other foods as well. In fact, even slightly steaming your vegetables releases some of the nutrients. However, our dependence on cooked food, that is when we eat 100% cooked food, we deprive our body of enzymes that would be available in the food. Now, a lot of nutritionists don't think that's important. Unfortunately, because they are important and they are helpful. So you should have some, at least some, maybe even most of your food intake should be raw. I would say 60, 70%. There's no way to really know, of course, but I'd say a lot of our food should be raw and we should cook. And largely because of this idea of the enzymes. Or if you're gonna cook your vegetables, don't cook them a lot. Just steam them slightly to release some of those nutrients that you do need heat for. All right, I'm Pharmacist Ben. 844-236-6010 is our number. Lines open for you. We'll be back on the Bright Side right after this. All right, we are back on the Bright Side. I'm Pharmacist Ben. 844-236-6010 is our number. Our lines are open for you. All our lines are open for you. We've got Kelly Sullivan Walden coming up at the bottom of the hour, author of The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle. We're going to talk dreams and dream analysis. She's also got something called her Dream Goddess Empowerment Deck and Dream Oracle Cards. And if you are out there believing that dreams and dream science and dream analysis is not important, think again. They're a super powerful way to understand why our lives are showing up the way they are, what's going on in our subconsciousness. And if your life is not showing up the way you want it to show up consciously, rest assured, there are subconscious reasons for that. Let me say that again. That's so important. Because we talk about nutrition a lot, and obviously I love nutrition. I love biochemistry. I love physiology. I love the material aspects of our lives and the physical aspects of our lives for sure. But if you are not healthy, 100% healthy, and you're doing everything physically correctly, you're doing everything correctly in terms of nutrition and you're exercising and you're doing everything, all the things you're told to do, but your life is somehow not, your body is somehow not showing up the way it should or the way you want it to, rest assured there are subconscious reasons for that. If you have money problems, if you have relationship problems, if you have life problems in general and you're doing things consciously, rest assured, and I talk to a lot of you guys on the phone. I talk to one guy on the phone almost every day. Not all, maybe every other day. And I'm sure he's listening to this program. And he's got eye problems, and he's got diabetic problems, and he always wants the latest machine. He's calling me up, this machine, that machine, this supplement, that supplement. Every time I have a guest on the program, he calls me up, wants to know, well, how do you get a hold of that guest? And I'm like, sir, I don't want to say his name. Starts with a K. I know you're listening out there. I say, sir, there's something percolating in your subconscious that you're not aware of and that you have to work on. And that you have to understand, if your life is not showing up the way you want it to, if your body is not showing up the way you want it to or the way it should, and you're doing everything correctly, you got to go to the subconscious. And you can't know what's in the subconscious because it's subconscious, but that's where dreams come in. Your life is a mirror of what's going on in your subconscious. The conscious mind is a mere 10%. It's like the tip of the iceberg. The bulk of the iceberg is underwater. The bulk of our thinking processes are underwater. They're underconscious, subconscious. By the way, I consider subconscious and unconscious to be the same. Sometimes there's confusion about that. The subconscious is unconscious. By definition, it's sub or it's un. We don't know what it is. But we can see what it is in the mirror, just like you can't see your face. You don't know what you look like unless you have a mirror. The mirror tells you what you look like. Reality tells you what your subconscious looks like or your unconscious looks like. Dreams represent a hack. Dreams are a hack into our unconscious or into our subconscious. We can hack into our unconscious or subconscious by our dreams. That's why dreams are so important. And if you're one of them, I'm going to ask Kelly this, by the way, because a lot of people can't remember their dreams. If you can't remember your dreams, start what's called a dream journal. Because oftentimes you can remember your dreams first thing in the morning, but they evaporate quickly. It's because there's nothing to grasp on with your dreams. When you have a dream, it's not based in a reality that you can really understand. You can live it, but you can't understand it. You can't duplicate it. That's why you wake up in the morning and there'll be just like kind of a vague feeling about a dream, but you won't know the details of that dream. As you learn to force yourself to go into the dream through writing, through journaling, your dreams will become more and more understandable, more and more memorable. If you are one of those people who remembers your dreams, you consider yourself lucky and blessed because dreams are amazing. And then there's the whole subject of lucid dreaming. That is really cool. I have had the fortune of having a couple of lucid dreams. But there are people who lucid dream all the time, especially young folks. Lucid dreaming is when you're awake in the dream. If you haven't studied that or read about that or thought about that even, just Google lucid dreaming. It is amazing. Oh my God. All kinds of things you could do in your dreams. Anyway, we'll talk to Kelly Sullivan Walden about dreams and dream consciousness and dream psychology, if you will, at the bottom of the hour. And it is the real deal, folks. All right, 844-236-6010 is our number. Our line's open for you. We're talking about enzymes, the power of enzymes. It's unfortunate that enzymes are marginalized because they are extremely powerful. Digestive enzyme supplements can be incredibly valuable, especially if you're dealing with inflammatory issues. They're anti-inflammatory. Understanding enzymes and enzyme biology is next to understanding nutrition, and I don't consider enzymes to be nutrition, at least not essential nutrition. But next to understanding essential nutrition, understanding enzymes and how to utilize enzymes is probably the most powerful supplemental strategy you can incorporate into your body. There are the essential nutrients, and then there's enzyme nutrition. The best source of enzymes, of course, are plants. Plants contain lipases, they contain proteases, I'm sorry, and they contain amylase, amylase being carbohydrate digesting enzymes. And, of course, they contain cellulases. The cellulases are the enzymes that break up cellulose. Our bodies can make proteases, our bodies can make amylases, our bodies can make lipases, but they cannot make cellulases. They cannot make the enzymes that break down cellulose. Human beings cannot break down cellulose. That's why we can't eat grass. If we could break down cellulose, we would have access to a lot more nutrition. Sometimes people will say, well, look at elephants. Elephants only eat vegetation, and look how big they are. And gorillas, they only eat vegetation. Look how big they are. Sometimes vegetarians will point to animals that just eat vegetables and say, look how big and strong they are. Well, they don't understand the nature of cellulases. Cellulases break up cellulose. So they can access the sugars that are in the cellulose. Cellulose is basically sugar, except it's undigestible sugar. On the other hand, if you have cellulases, if you're a ruminant, if you're a cow, or if you're a gorilla, Gorillas aren't ruminants, but if you're an animal that can break down cellulases, you can get lots of energy from grass. Look how abundant grass is. You can get cellulase enzymes, however, supplementally, and those can help for folks who cannot digest cellulose that's found in vegetables. A lot of people can't digest the cellulose that's found in vegetables, and they'll find themselves bloating or having digestive problems after they eat vegetables. This inability to digest cellulose, which is a component of the cell walls, a plant has a cell wall. Animal cells, there's two basic kinds of cells, of course. There's animal cell, well, there's a few basic kinds of cells, but one of the distinctions in cell chemistry is animal cells versus plant cells. The distinction between animal cells and plant cells involves a wall. Plants have a little wall surrounding the cell membrane. That wall is made up of cellulose and protects the plant. Animals don't have a cell wall. This cell wall is largely made up of cellulose, and this is where it becomes difficult to digest plant for some folks to digest vegetables. It shows they'll eat a raw veggie salad, and they'll bloat or they'll have digestive discomfort. And that usually involves an inability to digest cellulose. If that's you, start taking cellulase enzymes. You can find cellulase enzymes in most health food stores. In fact, I think the ultimate enzymes may contain cellulase. Cellulose is basically a prebiotic. It has detoxification properties. It can improve intestinal motility. We call cellulose insoluble fiber. And most people don't have a problem with that. But if you eat too much, you might have a problem with it. Or if you do ground up flax seeds, which I do every morning, you do too much, you may notice you have a problem with it. Most people won't have a problem. But if you do have a problem with eating vegetables, try getting on a cellulase enzyme or an enzyme supplement that contains cellulase. All right. I'm Pharmacist Ben. 844-236-6010 is our number. Kelly Sullivan Walden, author of The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle, will be with us next on The Bright Side. Don't go away. Are back on The Bright Side. I'm Pharmacist Ben, and thanks for joining us. We're on the air Monday through Friday, 8 to 9 Pacific and 10 to 11 Central Time, and 24/7 on the archive pages at benfuchsarchives.com, also brightsideben.com. We've got news stories and blog posts and videos at brightsideben.com, pharmacistben.com, and criticalhealthnews.com. Lots of great health information, as well as all the longevity products. And a Join the Team link that you can click on if you want to sign up to join the Bright Side Ben team at brightsideben.com, pharmacistben.com, or criticalhealthnews.com. You can also call 866-735-2470 for more information. And don't forget to take a look at our Truth Skin Health products, all formulated by myself in my compounding pharmacy for healing wounds and treating skin health issues like eczema and psoriasis, and just plain anti-aging, dealing with hyperpigmentation. Never any preservatives, fragrances, fillers, waxes, emulsifiers, water, silicone, vegetable oil, nothing your skin doesn't need or doesn't want in any of our Truth Skin Health products. And that's why we have over 1,600 four- and five-star reviews at truthreviewed.com. Truthreviewed.com, if you want to take a look at our four- and five-star reviews, or truthtreatments.com to purchase Truth Skin Health products. All right, I'm looking forward to speaking to our guest today. Kelly Sullivan Walden is on a mission to awaken the world to the power of dreams. I have been studying dreams for many years myself. I'm a big believer in dream psychology, in doing dream journaling. You can learn a lot about your subconscious mind, which, of course, is 90% of our reality, is the end result of what's going on subconsciously. And understanding your dreams is a powerful hack into what's going on in our subconscious or our unconscious mind. Kelly is the author of a book called The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle. She's been a regular guest on The Dr. Oz Show, Ricky Lake, The Real, Bethany, Coast to Coast, Hallmark's Home and Family. Please welcome to The Bright Side, Kelly Sullivan Walden. Good morning, Kelly.
Good morning, Ben. What a pleasure to be with you. Thanks for that introduction.
Yes, and thank you for doing what you're doing. I love studying. I love my dreams personally. I have the coolest dreams. And I've been studying my dreams for probably 30 years. I've had the fortune of having a couple lucid dreams. What do you say to people who don't remember their dreams?
Oh, man. Well, I always tell them that just by talking about them, getting interested in them is likely to stimulate some dream recall. But it's unfortunate, because it's this hidden resource that we have that is, it's like having a bank account with millions of dollars in it that we're not using. And it can change our lives, save our lives, give us so many gifts if we pay attention.
Yeah.
I love that. Like to inspire people.
Yeah, it's a resource that we have that we're just not utilizing. Tell us a little bit of why are dreams important?
Well, there's the very basic aspect of dreams that they help us to solve our problems, to sort out the glut of data. I love that you said that they're a great hack for being able to get to what's really going on. But if you think about it, like some people get inspired when they hear, like I wrote a couple, I was the co-author on two Chicken Soup for the Soul books, Dreams and Premonitions and Dreams and the Unexplainable. And those stories are filled with people whose lives were literally spared or changed or were made wealthy or found the love of their life because of dreams. So it's like there's historical figures. I mean, the fact that we even have electricity. Thomas Edison discovered the light filament in his dream. Einstein.
Yeah, I love that.
Changed his life. Exactly. And even clothes.
Tell us Einstein. Tell everybody Einstein's dream about the photon. You know that one, I'm sure.
Well, I know that the one that I'm mostly familiar with is the dream that he had as a teenager, where he was sledding, dreaming that he was sledding, and he surpassed his friends going so fast, and he broke through the time barrier.
That's
and he
great.
Had such an ecstatic physical memory of visceral memory of this like going beyond time and space that that feeling left an imprint. And it was said that on his deathbed, he said that he referenced that feeling to whenever he would feel stuck. Whenever he didn't know what to do with the problem, he would reference that feeling, and he would get his answers from there.
That's so awesome.
As a teenager informed. So with the photon, that's a different one. I haven't heard about that one.
He dreamt he was a photon, and he was going to the riding to the edge of the universe, and that's how he came up with this theory of light. Isn't that cool?
Oh my God!
Yeah. I know, right?
Cool. I know, and if it's like, so for people who doubt if dreams have validity, it's like, well, the Einstein. Yeah, his thumbs up. So,
the benzene ring too. The guy Kekulé dreamt. Yeah, a snake eating a snake, and he came up with the benzene ring.
Yes. Isn't that amazing?
That's so amazing. That's so
so many.
So you're tapping into something that's not just your personal wisdom, but like an archetypal wisdom, like a fundamental world wisdom. Correct? Sometimes
it's both. I think it's all of the above. It's kind of like the Russian dolls, the nesting dolls. There's there's the outermost layer that's most superficial, and then as we go deeper and deeper, each dream, even just a random dream symbol, has so much coding that it's both personal and it's also for the collective. And beyond. I mean, there's some dream symbols that I still just symbols that are still kind of blowing my mind with what they've opened up for me.
Well, how about this idea? If you probably heard this quote. I dreamt. I don't know if I was a man dreaming. I was a butterfly. I dreamt I was a butterfly, but now I don't know if I was a man dreaming. I was a or a butterfly dreaming. I'm a man.
Yeah.
How about this idea that our life is symbolic and our life is dreamlike in a way?
Well, it is, and the interesting thing is, as I write these books about dreams, I feel like I live my waking life 24 hours a day in the dream world, and then it starts. They definitely overlap, and there's a relationship between both. And at the very least, I feel like being in a dreaming consciousness, whether we're remembering a dream or trying to unpack it, it gives us greater. Harvard did a study that came out years ago, and it said at the very least, even if we don't know what our dreams are telling us, by paying attention to them, we become better problem solvers. We become better navigators of our lives. We have better intuition. So if nothing else, that's something.
Yeah. I mean, isn't there a power? There's like a power to seeing your life symbolically, like seeing the events symbolically or seeing the people in your life as kind of symbols of your psyche.
Right. And I think it's a great compassion maker because from the exercise of looking at every dream, every aspect of the dream as a part of the dreamer. So every person, whether they're an angel or a devil,
they're you.
They're you. And so to me, there's something inspiring about that because when I find myself getting judgmental in my waking life, mm-hmm. I have to see it also through the lens. Like, I've gotten into the habit of seeing everything like it's a dream. So anybody on the other end of the political spectrum or whatever, it's like, they're a part of me. They're a part of me that I either love or admire, or they're a part of me that I haven't embraced yet. So
in a way, we only love ourselves, or we only hate ourselves in a way, right?
I mean, exactly. Hello. Like, oh, good news, bad news. Right.
Good news, bad news.
But just like you said, I mean, I think the word I want to highlight here is the word hack, because most of us, we don't want to just tap dance on the surface, because we're being ignorance is not bliss. Ooh, I hear music.
Yeah, that's the music. That's your dream. That's your dream. No, listen, I'm kidding. Have you seen the movie The Waking Life, by the way? I'm sure you have. The Waking Life?
Yes. A long time ago.
I want to talk when we come back about dying in the dream and death in the dreams, because that seems to freak people out the most. But there's some real interesting meaning to that. We got Kelly. We'll be back right back after this break, okay, Kelly? Kelly Sullivan Walden is with us. Her book, The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle. We're talking dreams. Okay, we are back on The Bright Side. We're talking to Kelly Sullivan Walden, author of The Hero's Journey, Dream Oracle. Her website, KellySullivanWalden.com. She's got a Facebook page, Twitter account, Kelly S. Walden on Twitter and Instagram, YouTube's. Lots of good information about dreams. Kelly, one of the biggest things people talk about, or one of the most dramatic things people talk about when it comes to dreams, is dreams of dying or dreams of other people dying. But if dreams aren't literal, what is that all about?
Right. Well, every once in a while, dreams are literal, so we can't rule that out. But mostly dreams do speak the language of symbols. So looking at those dreams symbolically, death is the ultimate symbol of an ending of a pattern. And once a pattern is ended, that means that there's something new that can happen. So I always think about death and rebirth as being side by side, Siamese twins. Mm. So if there's somebody that dies in a dream, I always ask myself, what aspect of myself does this person represent? Is it an old boyfriend? Is it an old way of thinking? Is it, it's a part of me that needs to go. One of the stories in our Chicken Soup for the Soul, Dreams and the Unexplainable, actually Dreams and Premonitions, Reverend Michael Beckwith had a dream that he was being chased on an ongoing basis by a bunch of thugs, and they finally stabbed him after many nights of recurringly running. And he died in the dream. He was in pain. He felt the pain in his heart. And then he floated up into this place that he called Love Beauty, which sounds a lot like heaven. And from there, when he woke up the next day, his whole life changed. He had been a drug dealer, and he became he like went on a major spiritual path, and he's become the minister of a really like one of the biggest New Thought churches on the planet. So sometimes a death dream can foreshadow a radical change in your life. It doesn't mean you're going to die or somebody that you love is going to die imminently. I mean, of course, at some point we're all going to go. And sometimes these dreams, they can be helping us to prepare for that, but also they can be helping us to prepare to let go of something that feels like it would be the death of us, but really it could be the beginning of a new life.
Well, that is what death is. Death isn't, in a sense, it's not like permanent. Yeah. It's like just a transformation.
Exactly.
Right.
Right. Even death itself isn't as solid as we think it is. So permanent. It's the death of a body. That's like one millionth of who we are.
Right. Even less than that, probably. So what did you mean? But you said something really interesting. You said sometimes dreams are literal. What do you mean by that?
Yeah. Well, sometimes we do have premonitory dreams. Uh-huh. We will sometimes get a sense of something that is to come. Sometimes the dream isn't about us, but from one perspective, they all affect us in some way. It's always valid to look at how is this an aspect of me, and how is it symbolic. But it's always good to as well just pay attention to how certain premonitory dreams do come to us, because some of us have a pattern for knowing, because the only way to really know is once something plays out in waking life. Some people have a recurring theme of being in a movie theater, for example, and that's where they see their precognitive dream. Or there's a certain feeling that's just different than a regular dream that gives you the sense that this could be foreshadowing an actual event in your waking life.
Well, does that imply, like, if you have a dream about an event of the future, does that imply there's no future and that it's all happening at once, or there's kind of a leakage from something that seems to be the future? How does that work?
Oh, I love that. Well, this is definitely a metaphysical conversation. My perspective, I agree with the Daryl Anka, who channels Bashar. He says that it's not so much about past lives and future lives. It's about multiple simultaneous
lives. Parallel. Like it's all parallel.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So it seems like the future on some level. I mean, think of it as like one of those gigantic sandwiches that are just like a giant sub sandwich. It's just all part of the same thing.
Oh, it's like a wormhole. Like you're taking a wormhole to the lettuce. Like you're the bologna and you're taking a wormhole to the lettuce or something.
I want some cheese right now. Exactly.
Yeah. And is it always accessible? Is the lettuce all based on Bashar? And by the way, I love Bashar stuff, although I haven't listened to him for a long time. Is he still doing stuff? Or do you know?
I think so. I haven't talked to him in a while either, but having any conversation with him is eternal. So
okay. Is he always on like that?
Just like that lettuce.
Is Daryl always on like that?
No. Daryl is much more mild-mannered than... Okay. He's a calm... It's a shock. And yet, there is, I think over time, there's more of a synthesis between Daryl and Bashar. But it's pretty interesting. He's like the Clark Kent to his...
Okay, gotcha. So. Do you think we have to dream to get to those places, or can we get to those places through meditation, or even just in our waking life, in a regular waking life?
To get to what?
The lettuce, another parallel...
Consciousness?
Yeah, parallel kind of reality.
Oh, no, I think they're always available. Everything is always available. I mean, people will have spontaneous moments of awareness that have nothing to do with the book they're reading or who they're talking to or where they're at. It's always available. It just seems that we're more porous when we're speaking, and we're more of a captive audience. We're not as distractible by the density of the world. So it just seems more easy to get to us at that point.
Is there a relationship between dreams or lack of understanding of dreams and our collective insomnia issue that we have as a culture?
Oh, that's interesting. I would say that there's probably a very good corollary. I hadn't thought about that exactly. That's brilliant. But I think there is something about where we're sick or maladapted, it's related to what's happening internally. And I've become kind of lazy in a way where I think let's just fix it all on the internal plane. Let's just deal with everything on the level of dreams and watch what plays out in waking life. It's a lot easier to work in the realm of dreams. Like I can move mountains in my dreaming mind. I can travel without any travel bans, without having to wear a mask in my inner space, and I can meet with people. I can apologize to somebody. I can heal something, and then there is at some point once you've worked something out on the internal plane, there is a physical result. It might not happen that day. Sometimes it does happen that day, but there is definitely a relationship with what we do within our dreams and our dreaming mind and physical reality.
Are you lucid in your dreams?
Not all the time. I have been a handful of spontaneous times, but I'm not a regular lucid dreamer. I haven't gone after it. It hasn't been my passion in life. I'm like I said, I'm a little lazy. I like it when it comes to me, when I don't have to interrupt my sleep. I don't have to work that hard. I find that in naps, though, sometimes a nap in the middle of the day is the best because I don't need that sleep as much as I need my nighttime sleep. Mm. I really depend on that sleep. Also, there's some part of me, and this may sound like an excuse, but I also believe this, that I believe in the wisdom of our dreams to reveal what we need. And as much as I love those ecstatic moments of lucid dreaming, I really do love them. I also just love the grab bag. I love what happens in dreams, and there's a wisdom. Yeah. And it's like my ego runs my day. I don't want my ego running my night.
Got
as
it.
Well.
Got, very nice. Okay, so we all have about a minute. I hate to do this to you, but give somebody who wants to start dreaming, start working with their dreams, give us like just one quick tip. How can you do? What do you recommend? We have about a minute.
Get excited. get excited about them. Get dream FOMO. If you read one of the Chicken Soup for the Soul, Dreams and Premonitions, Dreams and the Unexplainable books, you're going to get dream FOMO. You're going to say, wow, I want to win the lottery because of a dream. I want to meet the love of my life, or I want to have a revolution in my marriage. I want to have these things. I'm going to pay attention to my dreams. Get very excited about them, and then don't move a muscle in the morning without having replayed and reviewed the dream you were just having at least three times.
Why do they leave so quickly?
It's the handing off of the baton between the subconscious mind, dreaming mind, and the conscious mind. It's just this gap. It's kind of like plating a different radio station. It's like going from a hard rock radio station to, or like going from a symphony to a hard rock radio station. We just forget. But it's still there. If we pay attention inside that gap is where the magic is.
Okay, so speaking of radio, you have a radio show too, right? Ask Dr. Dream?
Yes, it's on Unity Online Radio. Ask Dr. Dream.
Just Google Unity Online Radio. I haven't heard of that. Or Ask Dr. Dream?
Yes, good. That's it. Every Kelly, live.
Thank you so much for being on The Bright Side, Kelly Sullivan Walden. That was awesome. I appreciate it very much. We'll talk again soon. Thanks, Kelly.
Bye-bye.
KellySullivanWalden.com is the website. Kelly Sullivan Walden is on a mission to awaken the world to the power of dreams, and her book is The Hero's Dream Oracle. Thanks for listening to The Bright Side, friends. I am Pharmacist Ben. Have a wonderful, beautiful, awesome, spectacular day. We'll talk to you later, folks. Bye for now.